Hello, everyone. Can we talk about what the hell happened with Grease 2? I'm sorry, are you upset with me, Joe?
Kristen, this movie... Now, there's a reason that you're taking the lead here, because I refuse to write an intro about this movie.
I'm in trouble, so I am the beginning host of the podcast today.
And what podcast are we, Kristen?
This is the Can We Talk About podcast. We joked about covering this movie, and now we're doing the podcast equivalent of a walk of shame. Join us, won't you? I owe an apology to my brother. I'm Kristen.
I am very angry. I'm Joe.
And hey guys, I don't know why you'd want to, but you can watch Grease 2 on Netflix if you're feeling like indulging in some musical self-flagellation. I would personally recommend watching Grease 1 or Grease Live instead. What other movie would you recommend instead of Grease 2, Joe?
Well, I saw Civil War is on Netflix today, so if you haven't seen Civil War, go watch that, because that's a fun movie.
Cool. Let's get to the self-hating.
So Kristen, why don't you tell us a little bit about Grease 2?
Okay, first of all, a formal apology.
Good start.
That's all. Now for the movie introduction. So, the lead in this movie is some asshole no one's ever heard of because of Grease 2 named Maxwell Caulfield.
Well, Kristen, I had heard, and for some reason Maxwell Caulfield, I don't know if it's just my brain doing the synapses firing, like getting my streams crossed here.
Yep.
I was like, Maxwell Caulfield, yeah, he's probably J.D. Salinger's son, right? No, not the case. That's a different guy.
That's also the book he wrote, so.
Exactly.
Kids don't work that way.
I believe I read, Kristen, that Maxwell Caulfield was touted to be, at one point, he's gonna be the next Jim Travolta. Not the case.
Yeah, no. I don't know who exactly said that. I saw that quote as well on the Wikipedia page. For all I know, he could have said that and was just making himself out to be a little bit more of a star than he actually was. He plays Michael Carrington, who is apparently Sandy's cousin from England.
I think,
we have our first problem.
What's going on with Sandy's family tree there, then, that's going on?
You know, Australia and England are basically the same thing.
Europe. Yeah, Europe, two continents, fuck.
Same thing. Absolutely the same. Grease 2 did everything in its power to kill Maxwell Caulfield's career before it even started, and it mostly succeeded.
Yeah, I had heard, because as you said, we don't know who the hell Maxwell Caulfield is.
When I was checking out his Wikipedia page, apparently he's done, like, decently with theater roles, which is shocking to me, because holy shit, he cannot sing in this movie. But yeah, for like how many years he has been active, he doesn't have too many credits to his name, which is kind of a sign.
Yeah, that Grease 2 didn't go so well.
On the flip side, our second lead is Michelle Pfeiffer, that white gold. I left my own joke. Yeah, Uptown Funk.
Better known as Catwoman.
She plays Stephanie Zanoni, which is a weird last name, who is also playing Pat Benatar, I guess.
I mean, Michelle Pfeiffer, Kristen, she doesn't do too bad of a job in this movie, really.
No, like, again, as I did some research into the introduction of this movie, by all accounts, this movie should have worked out okay. Like, I can't figure out where the weak link is in this because, like...
The music, the plot, everything. Everything except Michelle Pfeiffer.
I mean, basically, who to assign the blame to specifically. Like, a name to assign the blame to. Because most of the people who worked on the production of this... completely fine people. One of them was the producer on Jesus Christ Superstar, so...
Should have worked.
The music was definitely the main problem. but as far as Michelle Pfeiffer, she went from Grease 2 immediately to Scarface, so things worked out good for her.
That's a marked improvement, I would say.
Oh yeah, I'm not overly familiar with the rest of her work, and I put after that, she's vegan?
Oh.
That's what Wikipedia told me.
I do know that one thing that was also said here is... Michelle Pfeiffer works as a much stronger female lead than Olivia Newton-John was.
If only she had better dialogue and a better plot.
I mean, even then, even with the shit that she's given in this movie, I'd say I like Stephanie more than I like Sandy.
It's hard when the movie is so bad. My mind has a difficult time separating potential character from what the hell is going on.
I guess, you
really could have condensed the main plot of this movie into a half hour. So just seeing Michelle Pfeiffer kind of act dumb for most of the movie, not, you know, her ignorance in the main plot and of what's going on is like, holy shit, Michelle Pfeiffer, open your eyes, use your ears.
One other thing, Kristen, apparently Grease was set to have a third movie and a TV series, but because
Joe, they were supposed to have four movies altogether.
Oh, even better.
But Grease 2 killed it dead.
And we didn't get anything until Grease Live.
Probably for the best. So, as for our actors, we do have several people coming back reprising their roles from Grease. No one told them not to, I guess.
Well, Kristen, when you look at the star-studded cast of people that return, first of all, I mean, okay, Coach Calhoun is Sid Caesar. Sid Caesar deserves a bit better than Grease 2.
Uh-huh, so we have Didi Khan coming back as Frenchie for about 5 minutes out of the whole movie.
I thought, you know, considering one of the few things that I knew about Grease 2 was the fact that Frenchie comes back, I thought she would have played a bigger part in the movie than kind of being...
She's like a grandma pink lady.
She's like the Pai Mei type to Maxwell here.
Yeah, apparently she is like still a pink lady, but not actually in the new group.
She has
of
the
pink
jacket.
Ladies. Yeah,
which...
it makes. Hey Joe.
Yeah.
This movie doesn't make any fucking sense.
No. We'll talk about it.
We have Eve Arden, who is returning as Principal McGee. Dodie Goodman as Blanche, who has a last name, which is surprising. Eddie Deason is back as Eugene and does not utter a single word in this movie.
Man, dark. No, he says like two or three things.
I don't remember him saying anything. Dennis C. Stewart back as Leo Balmudo, apparently is his last name, better known on Wikipedia, in parentheses afterwards, Craterface.
Because again, his character was not named in Grease 1, it was just Craterface.
I wonder what it's like for Dennis C. Stewart to have such bad skin that his character is AKA'd Craterface.
To have a Lemmy Kilmister face.
It's unfortunate. And Dick Patterson, who is Mr. Spears, who apparently was a different teacher in the previous movie. So whatever.
Yeah, that's how I got Mr. Spears, that cool joke that shows up two or three times.
Yeah, great. Great, and good. This movie, I continue in my notes, is a waking nightmare that should have never happened. The music was written by Louis St. Louis, which is unfortunate. He has such a good name. He wrote Sandy for Grease 1, and when you know that he wrote all of the music in this, everything makes a lot of sense.
We had said before recording here, Sandy, not too bad of a song, can't carry an entire movie with it, however.
Absolutely not. And, like, when you go to his Wikipedia page, it's like, he wrote Sandy. And that's, like, it.
Not even on there. Like, he wrote all the songs for Grease 2.
Well,
no,
there's that, too.
Excise that from my Wikipedia page, please.
Just get rid of it. I continue in my notes. This movie was edited by no one, I assume. So, this is where I continue. Based on my research into the creative minds behind the film, I cannot figure out the single weak point where it all fell apart. The acting and singing is bad, but the actors were also given not good material to work with.
Well, Kristen, I think it's about time that we explore this a little more deeply because it's the Adventure in China kind of situation. We're just putting it off at this point.
Mm-hmm. I do not understand how so many people let this movie happen.
So we start off, Kristen, we're going to be playing the first song of the movie here. It is called Back to School Again. It is performed by the Four Tops, if you notice that, Kristen. So that means Audrey 2 is somewhere among, I don't know if Levi Stubbs is like the main singer of the Four Tops, but he is doing something in this song, probably.
This is sad for him. Rest in peace, I think.
2008, yeah.
Okay. R.I.P. I wasn't sure.
So we'll play that for you right now, and we will get to Greasing.
Grease 2, time to die.
We start off, Kristen, it is the Paramount logo, the old Paramount logo, again on logos, whatever. We start off at Rydell. Is this
No
the
Love
same...
is a Many Splendor thing this time.
Is this the same Rydell?
Cause I think so.
I don't think it looks any different, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, it looks the same to me.
So Rydell comes up probably with different like lighting or props or something like that, but Blanche and Principal McGee come out first. They are about to raise the flag for the first day of the class of 1961. Kristen, what year was Grease 1? Was it supposed to be like...
59, right?
59? Okay, I thought so.
So again, already there are some issues.
Well, I mean, we'll get to Eddie Deason when he shows up.
Yeah.
They're going to raise the flag here. They banter back and forth about nothing. It really doesn't matter. You'll notice, Kristen, because of my sort of, I shouldn't even say deep hatred, because I don't hate this movie. I'm just terribly disappointed. I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed.
That's the worst thing you can be.
I kind of skimped on my notes here, so there's going to be a lot of just kind of me going, when this happens.
And then that thing.
So there's a car crash noise, and the flag falls down on Blanche and Principal McGee. Oh no, it's the crazy kids! Grease 2!
They're somehow shocked at the kids, as if it isn't the first day of school, and they haven't been teaching for a very long time.
I thought this was supposed to be night school, Kristen!
Oh no! I thought you were going to say night court.
Kids are dancing. It's back to school again. You heard the song here previously, a little bit of it. It's not a bad song, necessarily. It's got to fill a kind of big shoes with the normal Grease theme, which it certainly does not. It's, again, not a bad song. I, again, said to Kristen before we started here that this would sound more at home in the actual movie Back to School with Rodney Dangerfield from the 80s. This sounds much better for that. I have, yes.
Okay.
Didn't I tell you, Kristen, that that was when it has a young RDJ in it?
What?
Yeah, like...
How young?
Obviously, before the drugs and shit, RDJ.
20s?
Late 80s, yeah, so 20s.
Damn. I gotta Google this.
We see Eddie D's in here. He is Eugene. Kristen, Eugene graduated at the end of Grease. Why is he still here?
Apparently, the real world was so difficult that Eugene was just like, nah, I thrived in high school. I'm gonna stay here.
He's doing the thing of people who could have gotten their college degree, like, after 4 years of college, but he's there for 7.
Yeah, I guess so. He has a part-time job doing something. He's Rodney Dangerfield. He's going back to school.
Getting his books dumped and being pushed over.
Yep, so good job, movie.
The pink ladies arrive in their pink car. This isn't the same pink ladies' pink car, I don't think. Did they have a pink car in Grease 1? I don't remember.
I believe they did.
It's not some... Given the fact that, Kristen, the Pink Ladies and the T-Birds are, like, legacy groups in this high school, so...
I don't even want to get into, like, the idea of a hierarchy and, like, succession when it comes to weird gangs with rules that we didn't have in the previous movie. It's nonsense. It's Grease 2. Remember that thing from the other movie? It's in this movie, too.
I'd like to think that Rizzo just had the keys, because that's the thing, they should have been initiating new pink ladies if all of them graduated at the end of Grease 1.
Oh, but this is 2 years later. It's different.
We at least see Dolores is like an honorary pink lady, kind of, so she might be, she's part of the next wave of pink. I just like to think that Rizzo just like tossed the keys to Michelle Pfeiffer. She's like, fuck, take, I don't need this car anymore, please take it.
I'm going
it.
To college, I think. Worth mentioning, Jeff Conway and Stocker Channing very deliberately did not want to be in this movie. They asked them and they were like, oh no, absolutely not.
Good on you, Stocker Channing and Jeff Conway.
And apparently they had also approached John Travolta and Olivia Newton-John. No, like, actual word on why that fell through, but I'm assuming it's because they went, no!
I bet Olivia Newton-John probably didn't have a lot better to do, unless this was around the time of Xanadu, because I don't remember.
Who
Again,
knows?
Olivia Newton-John's career,
takes a weird path. What's she up to?
Who knows? Who cares?
Not much, I assume.
Getting physical. We see Michelle Pfeiffer. She is Stephanie Zanoni, you had said. I think you said her name already. Anyway, she's got sunglasses.
Stephanie Calzone.
Stephanie Calzone. She's got sunglasses. Is she the leader of the Pink Ladies, Kristen?
Yes, she is. She's just a bad leader. During this scene, one of them... God, because let me tell you, I can barely tell apart the other pink ladies, even though they all look drastically different. One of them is saying that, I think being late demonstrates very bad leadership qualities. And then Stephanie shows up and she's like, oh, we're going to be late. Let's go.
And then she
does like a cool girl thing with her jacket collar. God, okay. I hate this movie.
So we've got the other pink ladies here. We are introduced to them. They're referred to in my notes as Blonde Rizzo, who is Paulette, I'm pretty sure. She's the other important one. And she her personality is completely different from Rizzo. She just has the Stockard Channing haircut.
Yep. Clearly a wig.
Not Jan, who I don't know who that's in reference to. Marty 2 Electric Boogaloo, who is probably the one that wanted to get the nose job, maybe. What's her? Sharon was her name, I
guess
think?
So. Remember when Marty had glasses at the beginning of the other movie? Marty 2 has glasses also.
And Jackie O Pillbox Lady, who I don't remember her. Is she the one who sings
the
Nuclear
Rhonda.
Bunker song later? One of them's Rhonda? That might be her. I don't know.
Yeah.
And I don't know if Dolores is with them right now. If not Jan is Dolores, I'm not sure.
I don't think she's in high school yet.
We see some greasermen arriving as well. These are the T-Birds, and they park their motorcycles on the sidewalk.
Yep. You know what the most tragic part of this movie is, Joe?
Is it that one of the greasers is Shooter McGavin?
What?
Did you not notice the goose is Shooter McGavin, Kristen?
No, I didn't! I wasn't looking for Richard and McGavin.
I noticed it, like, immediately.
Shit. Well, I'm glad I know that now.
Literally, my notes go, can all these kids park here, like, on the sidewalk, and then in all capital letters, one of these greasers is Shooter McGavin.
I am looking at your notes and I didn't even notice that. Holy shit. What I was going to say is the really tragic thing about this movie, in my opinion, is I feel like these T-Birds could have been good if written differently.
You know what? I think Johnny's not bad. He's not, like, leader T-Bird material, or maybe that's
he's
the kind of thing.
He's an interesting character.
If they explored the idea that, you know, the T-Birds aren't great because Johnny's not really a great leader, I don't know.
Yeah,
but
like...
But they didn't.
Yeah, do something besides have some T-Bird politics going on, instead of at the end of the movie being like, Michael, you win the T-Birds!
Spoiler alert.
No one cares, I guarantee you.
The T-Birds have their normal kind of banter where it's clearly not as strong as the first movie, where their big exchange is, what do you want to be when you grow up?
A burden on society.
We see some teacher woman with a ton of hairspray is here. This is Miss Mason. I expected Miss Mason to have a bigger part in the movie. She doesn't really do anything.
Nope, she's just there to have the boobs.
She has music appreciation class, and one of the T-Birds makes a joke about seeing all of Miss Mason in class to her face.
They want to see the boobies, the teacher boobies. Show me the teacher boobies.
Starring Maxwell Caulfield, here he is getting off the bus, and Frenchie's here too. Poor Didi Khan. Oh, Didi Khan, how much did they pay you to be in this movie?
I hope enough.
We learn that Michael, this is Michael, and he's Sandy's cousin, which, as you said, Kristen, something you brought up here, from England, so...
Yeah.
I know both countries speak English, but...
I mean, it's completely possible for someone to have, like, you know, I could have a cousin in England, or Italy, more realistically.
Yeah.
But to have someone, okay, to rewrite the character of Sandy in the first movie to make her from Australia, and then purposefully hire another person with an accent for her cousin, and then have him be English, seems really stupid.
Is Maxwell Caulfield English?
That's a great question. Yep, he's British American.
All right, good. So he has the accent. So it's not him putting on an accent. Maybe he played it up a bit, because he is able to do both a British accent and an American accent when he's being the cool writer later. But
yeah, his American accent was okay. He didn't say very much, so that helped him.
So yeah, small world, huh? With the fact that Sandy's cousin is the male lead of this movie, but... Whatever. So Frenchie's going to show Michael the ropes, and then Frenchie quickly recaps her character arc from the first movie to Michael.
And apparently, they decide to continue having Frenchie have, like, shallow goals, because she's like, I went to beauty school and it kind of sucked. Now, cosmetics, that's what I'm into.
So she's here at the school to, she said, earn her chemistry or something like that?
It sounds to me like she is just back in high school. I would like to point out, she only missed, like... how do semesters work in high school again? She
gotta go back. Back to school.
I graduated
again.
From college. I do not need to go back to school. Anyway, she missed a little bit more than half of her senior year. This is 2 years later. Frenchie should have graduated by now.
We have Michelle Pfeiffer's name coming on screen. I wrote her name as Michelle Pfizer. I love her pharmaceuticals.
Very funny.
The Pink Lady's pledge is to look cool, act cool, be cool. That doesn't come back. I just wrote that down because I was like, I wonder if that's going to come up.
Absolutely not. And do you remember that cool Pink Lady catchphrase from the last movie?
Oh, till death do us part, think pink, that thing that Rizzo was saying all the time.
Yeah, I believe Stalker Channing has that on her tombstone, but I think she's still alive, actually. I'm just saying it had a really big impact after the first movie, which is why I clearly returned for the second movie.
Here's where Frenchie talks about her skincare thing, and she talks about what her plans are, and Michael goes, makes sense, probably not really listening to Frenchie, much like myself, because again, I didn't write down what exactly Frenchie said.
Poor Didi Khan.
Poor Sid Caesar, again, he is Coach Calhoun, he does maybe three things in this movie. He does more than in Grease 1, but he didn't need to do more than what was happening in Grease 1.
Yeah, Coach Calhoun appears to be on speed in this movie. It's like, hey, remember how Coach Calhoun was the thing with the sports in the last movie? He's sports!
He is sports. And as
sports!
And as such, we see people at Rydell playing what looks like ABA basketballs for some reason. They're not like the straight orange. I don't know. Fuck it.
Why not?
And then I wrote, I wish Shooter McGavin was the lead of this movie.
The actor or the actual character?
I would have liked Shooter McGavin, along with Richard Kiel, to be the male leads of this movie.
Nice, I like it.
And he shoots the golf ball off his foot and it gets caught in the motorcycle spokes of Crater Face, and that's how the movie ends.
And then they go to Red Lobster.
and he eats pieces of shit like you for breakfast.
We really talk about Happy Gilmore a lot, don't we?
Everyone starts piling into the school. Principal McGee looks concerned again, like, what are all these kids doing at school?
Oh, it's so strange.
The T-Birds and the Pink Ladies are some of the last to enter, and here's where Johnny does his first thing where it's, you know, he'll do the, like, you know, snap his fingers, comb, you know, lighter. Gentlemen, start your engines.
I'm working real hard on this accent.
We're gonna be doing that accent a lot, aren't we?
Oh, God, we are.
You're gonna love Rydell, is what Frenchie says, and then my next note after that is just, nah.
And at the end of the song, there's, like, the last, like, beat, and some dude jumps through the window. And that's funny, I guess.
Well, as we pull away, there was a thing that happened where, as everybody was, like, walking towards the school, a kid with a cello, like, bumps into Shooter McGavin, and then he takes the cello thing, and then as we're pulling away, we see the cello has, like, gone...
I think it might be an upright bass. It looked pretty big.
Well, whatever. Like, through the flagpole, though. Like, really near the top of the flagpole. I don't know how that happened.
Greaser magic.
Shooter McGavin, he's got greaser magic, Kristen.
Woo!
He doesn't get a song in this movie. What the fuck?
I'm sorry, did you really care about Goose's character arc?
The Pink Ladies are bantering inside now. Rhonda, I think, is the one with the nose. She's talking about how her nose is not her nose or whatever. And then another one asks, what's going on with the look? With the pillbox hat? And Kristen, this is the one that I referred to as Jackie O before they named drop Jackie O in the movie.
Yep, there's, man, a shitload of references to the Kennedys in this movie.
I mean, there was one or two in Greece, right? So,
I don't remember them talking about the Kennedys much.
I thought, I don't know. Well, no, John F. Kennedy, I don't think, would have been president at that point. I don't know, whatever, fuck it. Talk about Senator Kennedy, maybe? I don't know.
I don't remember that either.
Anyway, Jackie O, lady with the pillbox hat, she said that that's her look because it nabbed her a president, where Blonde Rizzo here, Paulette, says that Marilyn Monroe is her inspiration, and she hears that that is what Mr. Kennedy goes for instead.
Uh-huh. Wigs, it turns out.
Johnny and Goose are here, and here's, yes, I wrote in my notes, Goose is Shooter McGavin, Johnny has a pompadour.
Yes, he does. Pretty good hair.
He does have good hair in this movie. Whoever his actor is.
Whoever this man is.
Michelle Pfizer is Stephanie, and apparently Johnny and Stephanie were a thing, but they ain't anymore, and don't make a scene about it.
Yep, this happens about 10 times in the movie. Oh, we're not together anymore? No, we're not together anymore. Bah!
So we're not together anymore.
And they go over it several times.
Lewis is one of the T-Birds. I don't remember which one he is. I just wrote in my notes about that. They talk about National Bandstand because one of them has a picture of Vince Fontaine in her locker, and I was really
hoping that thing from the other movie?
I was really hoping they just did that again rather than the talent show.
We gotta give them some credit, I guess.
Yeah, okay, yeah, Rhonda's the one talking about her nose, and she says something along the line, this doesn't go anywhere either!
Nope.
One of them warns Rhonda not to mess with nature, because it sounds like, I was gonna say, you know, is that gonna be a plot point, her getting a nose job? And she does at some point, but it doesn't come up after that.
Stephanie and Paulette have plot lines.
Have the only plot lines.
That's it.
Stephanie heads back towards her locker as the others walk away, because I think one of the other girls, that as like they were walking through the halls, noticed that Stephanie's still wearing pants.
Yeah, I don't understand. Okay, 60s culture, who knows? She had pants on, someone says pants, and she goes back to her locker and gets a skirt out of it and just puts it on over her pants.
Yeah, puts on a long skirt, which that may have been dress code, Kristen, who knows?
Maybe.
Not that necessarily that Rydell has a dress code, but maybe that it's one of those things where...
Women can't wear pants.
60s. Fuck it.
When you wear pants, that's when you become a lesbian. And that's how you ruin the home.
Eddie Deason is here with Michael, and one of the few times where I laughed in this movie, Eddie Deason is speaking to Michael like he can't speak English. Like, he goes, so how long have you been in America?
Bueno! It's like, what? Where'd you even get that from?
And then he immediately drops it, because Eddie Deason is just showing Michael the lockers, and... I mean, Eddie Deason gets scared because he sees the T-Birds, and if Eddie Deason still, like, I understand him being scared of the original T-Birds, he shouldn't be scared of these T-Birds.
Well, I think he's scared of everyone, to be fair.
True. Michael attempts to take a locker labeled as part of a row of lockers that spells T-Birds, and the T-Birds do not like this.
Thankfully, they are right there to stop him from doing it. I don't know why you would want a locker that has something graffitied on it anyway, but...
Yeah, so they kind of grab Michael... and kind of lead him down the hallway, and then just shove his head into a locker that doesn't have a door on it.
It's very funny.
Why not just take the locker next to the one that says T on it?
Children ask questions.
Stephanie walks by, and she's like, oh, don't worry about the T-Birds, don't let them bug you.
And then, Michael falls in love. Nerd love. Here's the plot of the movie.
We join a class in progress here. Stephanie chides the T-Birds, but the nerd invaded our turf, our locker turf.
That's true, he did.
And Johnny wants to talk to Steph, so, you know, meet me for a smoke later. Oh no, I quit. Bad for your health, after all.
Good girl.
Standing me up is also bad for your health.
That's a threat.
Miss Mason is here. I called her Miss Hairspray. Dudes are wolf whistling at her, which is...
I guess allowed in schools in the 60s.
Blanche's xylophone is different, Kristen.
She got an upgrade.
She got a giant xylophone now.
She might as well have, like, God, what are the pipes called that you bang on?
The Blue Man Group things, the PVC tubing?
Yeah, no. A thing that an actual orchestra uses.
They redo the gag from the last movie, too, where she just plays.
Remember that thing from the other movie, Joe?
They do, yeah, it's the same thing where Principal McGee is just talking about, oh, it's a new year. There's a teacher choking down pills. This is Mr. Sears or something.
Spears.
No, George Sears.
Sears. Whatever.
He's choking down pills. They do the mouse to scare a woman gag again.
Do you remember that thing from the last movie?
Oh, God. Frenchie's doing science things and it blows up. There's going to be a talent show, the June Moon Talent Show.
Time moves even faster in this movie than it did in the last one.
I thought, now they kind of did this. Now, for the talent show, I don't remember who leads it. It might be the Jackie O Pillbox one, who is the one who leads the Girl for All Seasons song.
Yes.
I thought they were doing a thing where, in order to signify how far into the movie it, or how far into the school year it was, I guess, they would do the section of the song. Like, because they start with fall, and then they do the winter part. And then they skip right to the spring part.
I don't think it actually means anything. You're giving the movie too much
credit. They could have done a cool thing there, is all I'm saying.
Oh, they could have, Joe. They could have.
But they didn't. Anyway, for some reason, Principal McGee is just like, and we're pleased to announce we have a straight-A student here today. It's a Michael from Britain. Michael, Sandy's cousin Michael.
You guys remember Sandy, right? Cousin. I, like, had one of those things that I occasionally have when I'm watching a media where people unknowingly ruin someone's life. Where it's like, oh yes, everyone, pay special attention to Michael. He is so much smarter than you.
We immediately cut to band practice. Like, bands are practicing. Principal, you mentioned something about band practice, and we cut to bands practicing. That doesn't lead anywhere. It's just a means for the Pink Ladies are discussing what happened with Johnny and Stephanie. It is ancient history now. And then some twins come out here. And Kristen, I'm curious, because there are two separate occasions where, Miss Mason refers to the twins as her girls. So are they her daughters, or...?
No, I think just her favorite students or something. Again, this is a, like, even more intense version of, like, the thing with Patty Simcox, where I was like, I don't understand why everyone hates these people. Like, they seem a little bit overbearing.
No, they're
and,
fine.
And, like, intensely goody-two-shoes, but that's not, like, a bad thing. The Pink Ladies come over and go, woo-woo-woo-woo, virgin alert!
I feel like that they'd be cool people to hang out with, but yeah, they go and accost Michael as he's running, wearing the same shitty, like, gray sweats that John Travolta was wearing in Grease.
So attractive. Everyone looks good.
Very Rio of him.
So Rio. That's so Rio. They do ask him to play piano for the talent show auditions, and he's like, okay.
That doesn't lead anywhere either.
Not really. He's just around during the talent show stuff where he might not have been otherwise.
I mean, I thought it was going to be, he was going to do a cool thing in the talent show to earn the love of Michelle Pfizer.
Nah, he dies. It turns out dying is a really good solution to most problems.
Frenchie comes along too, and I'm just like, Christ, leave the kid alone, Frenchie. You don't need to talk to him every time you see him.
Did you graduate yet?
Did you graduate yet?
That's so mean!
The Pink Ladies, yeah, come over and they go, virgin alert, like Dot and Spaceballs at the twins for some reason, and I don't know.
They're very funny and very nice people.
Anyway, it's already been a week, according to Frenchie, and then Michael is just like, so tell me about Stephanie, tell me about Michelle Pfizer.
I want to bone her, so what's up?
And Frenchie okay, Kristen, here's where we get maybe my biggest problem with the movie?
You mean the nonsense? The nonsense.
Frenchie lays down the groundwork here. Apparently they got some kind of fucking eternal yin and yang thing going on where the T-Birds and the Pink Ladies are the only people that are, like, allowed to date each other. Like, you
Since
can't date...
when?
If you're not a pink lady, you can't date somebody who's not a T-Bird. And if you're a T-Bird, you need to date a pink lady?
Then who is Frenchie dating?
Is Frenchie a pink lady?
She has the jacket still.
She's not... I don't know.
Fuck she it. Claims to be very good friends with Stephanie.
I don't know.
This movie is a trash fire.
Anyway, Frenchie warns Michael that he shouldn't even look at Stephanie, so...
And God bless his heart, Michael takes that as encouragement, and he's like, so how do I become a T-Bird? I want to be like those dicks that bullied me.
And then we see Coach Calhoun is likening football to life. He likens everything to football, including nuclear war later, so...
Yep.
He's talking about how life, you gotta push. It's football is just like life, you gotta push. And it's like, if you gotta push your way through life. I thought he was referring to birth here.
Nah.
You gotta push your way into life.
Anyway, apparently the T-Birds are the ones doing this football drill, even though they're not football players, whatever. And they keep pushing and he, like, tips over and falls into a pit of some sort.
I refer to it as an open grave.
That's appropriate. I'll just stay here and die.
So here's a motorcycle gang, Kristen. These are not the Scorpions. They have a different name entirely, but I didn't learn it.
It's the Cycle Lords or something.
They're the Scorpions.
Lords of Cycle Dance.
Because they got crater
Scorpions
faces.
Scorpions 2, let's try again.
Because they still got crater faces, their leader.
Yeah, whoever. I believe the Wikipedia page is like, we can assume that Crater Face and several other defunct Scorpions are now in this Viking gang.
Fuck off.
And it's now such a large gang as well that the police should be called on them like 10 times in this movie. So the fact that they are still just bopping around and not in jail makes zero sense.
Oh, but yeah, they drive like directly on school property with these motorcycles too, which Principal McGee accosts Johnny about this later, but it doesn't really, again, doesn't really go anywhere. So Craterface has been stepping to their territory one too many times, and the T-Birds think they should take care of Craterface and his crew, but Johnny's just like, kind of got bowling tonight, so...
Unfortunately, I'm a coward tonight.
Like, his voice breaks here, and I think that's a good...
He could have been so interesting.
He could have been a good character, because playing up Johnny as... Like, it would have been... Wouldn't it have been great if there was some kind of thing where there was a guy who graduated, like, last year, and he was, like, the really super cool T-Bird leader, and Johnny inherited the T-Birds, and he is having trouble... He's having trouble filling these shoes as the leader of the T-Birds, and he grows, and he's a cool badass by the end of the movie.
See, I was even going to say at the end of the movie, maybe he's like, maybe I shouldn't be in a gang.
Even, yeah, whatever. And that's fine.
I'm happier not being in a gang. Can I keep my jacket? I can. Wow. Thanks. Friendship. Movie over.
Fuck. 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 Jesus. Anyway.
Don't start now, Joe. We got a long way to go.
The T-Birds ain't what they used to be, is all I'm saying.
Uh-huh. So some bowling is gonna happen.
Kristen, there's a song about bowling here.
Oh, yeah. I remember when I first saw this movie, this is the one that stuck with me, like, several years before I saw it again. And I was like, whoa, that was a dumb song. Also, a disgrace to bowling.
So, Paulette and Johnny are together now, I think, because that's... I think a lot of Johnny's plot of this movie is to try and... use Paulette to make Stephanie jealous, kinda.
Yeah, because he is not great to her for most of the movie.
Yeah, and Paulette doesn't really notice, maybe?
Oh, she does get annoyed with it after a while.
But people are, like, running down the lanes to it. Like, the first thing when we cut to the bowling alley here, Shooter McGavin is running down the lane and throws the bowling ball into the lane.
What kind of shoes is he wearing? Because he should have slipped and smacked the back of his head and bled out. On that bowling lane.
It was the 60s, Kristen. Because even during the song, too, people are running halfway down the lane before they throw the bowling ball.
During the song, while they're dancing, I get it. While it's literally just a scene of them bowling, I do not.
Maybe they didn't grease the lanes in the 60s yet. I don't know.
That would be crazy. You know, modern bowling, aka bowling from when we were younger, if you accidentally step on the line, a big buzzer happened and it's like, hey, back up, fucko! No such thing here.
Well, there's no automatic scoring either, because Johnny's just like, yeah, mark that a strike. And one of the pink ladies is like, but that was a 2.
And he said, hey, you guys were late. It's a technical strike. Learn the rules!
Read your bowling rules!
Read your bowling rules!
Read your bowling rules.
Read your, please, this holiday season, read your bowling rules. Will that joke still be funny? We're recording this right before New Year's.
Save a life. Read your bowling rules.
Save a horse.
ride your bowling rules. Anyway, Paulette goes to roll her ball, and it's just like, you gotta put your fingers in the holes!
Ah, and she's like, I'm not breaking my nails, and then flexes her ass bones towards the camera for about 10 minutes before finally rolling the ball.
Yeah, and she gets a strike. So here's, yeah, I wrote at this point because I don't, what is the name of this song? Let's Bowl?
Maybe.
Whatever. The song starts and I wrote in my notes, oh right, there's supposed to be music in this movie.
And then you said, a song about bowling, I like this movie already. You were wrong.
I was being facetious, first of all.
Oh, okay. I can't tell in your notes.
There's euphemisms about scoring, Kristen. That's this song. That is the entirety. That's what this song is here to do. It's like, we're gonna go bowl and then we're gonna go bone.
Yep. Bowl and bone.
Bowling for bones.
Bowling for bones. If we say it enough times, maybe it'll stop hurting.
The 60s were a really wild time. People are dancing. Johnny screams really high because this is a Johnny song, right?
He's trying to hit a high note. He's trying to do like a Prince thing, except it sounds like he hurt his knee sliding down the lane. He's like, ah!
I noted at this point, Kristen, the T-Birds have special T-Bird bowling uniforms as well.
They do, and those look amazing.
I think they're stupid.
Oh, I think they look great.
And then, here's where the madness of this movie started to go in, because I'll read you my notes of verbatim here. It goes, all right, I think I've had enough of this song. Please stop dancing. Sped up film of people spinning. Mm-hmm. I spoiled myself on Kristen's joke of, I don't think anyone edited this film, so I'll let her have that. And then we finally get back to Michael is outside, and he has some kind of how to talk bowling guide to help him out.
Yeah, again... What country did he come from, actually? He's, like, literally reading out loud. Always be courteous when asking for a game. Okay. Bowling anyone? Nice. Nailed it.
He's also wearing a yellow sweater.
Yeah, he dresses real dopey at the beginning of this movie. Luckily, that goes away pretty quickly.
Yep. And he's too late. Everyone's done. Johnny wins Paulette, I guess, and they kiss, and it's kind of, like, awkward there. And then he goes, all right, well, that was the trophy for best average, really socking it to Paulette there. And then he goes, well, all right, but how about the trophy for best score, Stephanie?
Yeah, Paulette doesn't look thrilled that they just kissed, and then he was like, now you, Stephanie, kiss me.
She ain't nobody's trophy, Kristen, which elicits a response from the T-Birds, like, oh, nobody's trophy.
And she says, I kiss who I want, when I want. I could even kiss the next guy that came through that door.
And they're laughing because it's an old dude, and she starts walking over, but luckily Michael comes in and he gets kissed!
Movie things. This has definitely happened in like 5,000 different shoujo manga I've read. I'm just saying.
Johnny is shocked, to say the least, at this development as well.
Michael asks if it's too late to join the game, Governor.
And they all, the T-Birds and the Pink Ladies leave, but they leave Dolores behind. And Dolores has.
Because they hate her.
Dolores has a skateboard here.
Dolores is Paulette's little sister.
Yes, thank you. They mentioned that once.
Yep.
Michael wants a motorcycle that he mentions to Dolores. Dolores says she's the Pink Ladies' mascot.
Well, kind of, but not really, because that's what she suggested, and they were like, no. And now she just kind of follows them around. She was returning their bowling shoes when we saw her.
Right, yes, of course. So that, yeah, she's kind of the flunky of the Pink Ladies, I guess.
Mm-hmm. And she said that when she is in high school and she's a Pink Lady, oh god, there's gonna be some changes.
Dolores, 1963.
Yeah, Dolores is one of the only okay things about this movie.
Yeah, I like Dolores, even though she doesn't really do much in the movie.
No, I appreciate that in this single scene with her and Michael just talking back and forth, she is complaining and then ends her complaint with, pisses me off.
She says it like 3 times.
Yeah.
Not only, Dolores gets more character development in this one scene than 90% of the characters, probably.
Yep, great job, Dolores. I hope her actress is doing good.
I hope so as well. So Michael offers to walk her home, and she's like, I don't need a babysitter. And he's like, well, how about a date?
Oh, well, a date. When they go at the front door, I do remember laughing because not even, like, focusing on them at all, we are still, like, viewing them from inside the bowling alley, I think. Paulette sticks her head out of the window of the Pink Lady car and goes, Dolores, go home!
They don't even drive her home.
No.
So wonderful. So we cut to the next day. The Pink Ladies park in faculty parking. Mr. Stewart is here. Mr. Stewart doesn't do fucking any. He takes part in one song, and it looks like there's going to be a thing with him and Miss Mason, and that's it.
Nope. There's a nothing.
He's a substitute. Let me just skip past all this, because again, here's where he's talking to Miss Mason about nothing. Like, I love your hair. Cool.
Great. We do find out that the prize for the talent show is 100 records.
and that comes up, but it's kind of not...
It's mainly just motivation to justify why the T-Birds would want to be in a talent show.
I guess, yeah. Shooter McGavin really wants those Roy Orbisons.
Sure. They also call them Albumins.
I don't know why.
For most of the movie. I think they're just all really bad at talking. That's my guess.
Oh, fuck. All right. Well, Mr. Stewart is here to sub in for Mr. Spears, who was the guy who was choking down pills earlier in the movie, and then everybody leaves once Mr. Stewart says that he's a substitute teacher. Blah, blah, blah.
That's kind of a funny joke.
Yeah, I like that. Johnny is smoking in the halls with Goose, and then Principal McGee stops them, and Johnny does the cool, like, Jotaro thing of cigarette flipping into his mouth to hide it.
This scene was a little bit funny, too.
Yeah, this wasn't too bad. It was a lot of, you know, Principal McGee was asking, like, what's going on with the motorcycles out there? That's not going to happen again, is it? And
Johnny's just making faces the whole time, like...
And then Principal McGee walks away, and Goose smacks Johnny's back, like, aha, we really pulled one over on her, and then that makes him swallow the cigarette.
Yep. It was kind of funny. You won't get it again, movie.
We cut to Michael playing some piano to help with the auditions here. The twins are singing a song about some guy who looks like Benny from New Vegas.
He shot me in the head. gonna take him to Bone Town, then kill him. That's how Kristen plays New Vegas. Again, half the songs in this movie sound exactly like songs I make up off the top of my fucking head, and that's exactly the problem.
This might have been a real song, because we do get the Mr. Sandman song later, too. It's something about a guy named Ben?
No.
Or something?
It's a dumb, plain, dope name. Like Craig.
Anyway, Dolores comes to talk to Michael, but he's a little busy playing piano. Dolores, can you wait?
Apparently he could talk and play piano, though. He's that good.
The Pink Ladies are, we're seeing the initial stages of the Pink Ladies song, which is A Girl for All Seasons, which will be played later in the movie, including such things as one of them wearing a box that says tree on it.
Nice. Yeah, their costumes evolve as the school year goes on.
The Girl for All Seasons song starts playing here. I think they do the part with Fall here, and we have Michelle Pfeiffer with the line of the movie thus far when she's kind of hanging out near Michael, and Michael's just like, so, are you free after school today?
I'm free every day. It's in the Constitution.
Boom. I love it.
She is, like, so deadpan sassy that it makes me angry. I, like, consider, like, myself in my day-to-day life, and I think to myself, like, if I saw someone out in the city and spoke to them, which I would never do, and I was like, oh, hey, I like your shoes, where did you get them? And they looked at me and went, a store, and then walked away, I would be so pissed off.
That's just their style, Kristen, you don't know them. Who are you to judge?
Yeah, I don't want to know them.
So the song gets stopped here because they gotta, you know, have drama class, and Jackie O is just like, but we still got three more seasons! And fuck it, whatever.
Uh-huh. The whole directing the tune for the talent show thing doesn't go anywhere and is boring and takes up your time and my time and the listener's time.
Yep. So Michael is just like, hey, Steph, why don't we get a hamburger? Nope, I'm busy. How about tomorrow? I'm busy tomorrow. What the hell happened at the bowling alley?
It was a joke. You kiss a guy on the mouth. Get over it.
She doesn't want to hang out with Michael. And here we get now a song by Michelle Pfeiffer. Cool Rider.
Pat Benatar.
She wants a biker dude boyfriend, Michelle Pfeiffer does.
But not any of the T-Birds.
And here is where Kristen, it finally took me until this point in the movie to realize, are they trying to do like a motorcycle thing as the Greased Lightning of this movie?
Kind of.
I mean, look at the logo. It is a motorcycle.
It is a motorcycle. Good observation.
And then my next note is, I have nothing to say about this.
Yeah, like, one of the things, my issues with this movie, is it is shot very badly.
Yes.
There's just, and there's an intense amount of long static shots on people. Did you notice that?
I didn't, but then again, I wasn't really watching the movie as closely as I could have.
I just got infuriated because, like, people would have whole conversations without the camera fucking moving. This movie must have taken 2 years to shoot.
So Steph starts the song. She's singing it to, I believe, you know, whoever's around. And then she kind of starts singing it to herself. And then she heads out from wherever.
Just leaves the school.
She starts singing and dancing out in the street. And Michael's watching from, like, from far, being just like, wow.
He's taking notes.
I love that dancing woman.
Cool Rider. I will do some research, and I can do that.
One of the T-Birds is here. He's the nuclear fallout shelter one. I don't remember. Demucci? Is that his name? This one?
Maybe.
I don't know. Anyway, he's got something scholastic to discuss with Mr. History over here.
I would appreciate if you could write some papers to me in return for some cash.
And Michael's just like, no, I want a motorcycle. And he's just like, how about cash?
It's the best I could do. It's a paper. Get over yourself.
We see Michael is doing some homework in a fallout shelter for some reason, and here is where we get the the fallout shelter. Demucci is here because we're going to see him here later. He's like, oh, you could do a lot of stuff in this. There's going to be a lot of fake.
You could coerce a girl into having sex with you here.
Like Dennis out on the boat.
Yep. Because of the implication of nuclear war.
And we see he does this for Shooter McGavin as well, and he does it for Johnny, and all of them say, hey, this is just between you and me. I got a rep to protect.
There's a really good scene where he's doing the handoff with Johnny, where he actually, like, takes the paper out to look at it and goes, oh, this is your really nice penmanship. Don't tell anyone, though. I hope that that actor is okay. He seems precious, and I feel like I want to protect him.
Unfortunately, he's stuck in this movie.
Unfortunately.
So, here we are, Kristen. Could this be the worst part of the movie?
Oh no, I see further down in your notes you just wrote, fuck you, Kristen. Oh god.
With good reason, because we are in sex ed class, Kristen.
I'm so glad we don't live in the same place, because I feel like there would be retaliation in store for me if you could actually, like, punch me.
Oh, all right, so Mr. Stewart is here, he's teaching the class, he asks, starting with Johnny, like, oh, what's reproduction, or what's procreate, or something.
When's the best time for a woman to conceive?
There we go.
Which is an important thing that people should know. Joe, these people are seniors and they're having sex ed!
Johnny's reading a Playboy behind his book, which he quickly puts away. Mr. Stewart's having a real rough go of it, because Johnny goes, as Goose. And Goose is just like, as Demucci. And Demucci's like, as Lewis. And Lewis is just like, oh!
Sex!
Oh, and here we get Reproduction, Kristen, I believe would be the name of the song. Again, this was a slow descent into madness, I would say, this song.
This song is definitely the worst thing about the movie.
All right, there's a flower metaphor. Again, I'll read my notes here.
Okay, go right ahead.
Flower metaphor. Please kill me. Oh God, I want to die. Fuck you, Kristen. Stop.
It's like, oh, you know all those funny words you learned about how plants reproduce? Let's just use them in sentences that you would just go, cock!
Let's turn the birds and the bees into a song with people who are not mature enough to keep it.
With teenagers.
With teenagers, yes, thank you.
Joe, I don't know about you. Now that I am in my 20s, I don't like hearing characters, even if they are... I don't like hearing teenagers, even if they're fictional characters, talking about sex, because I'm like, you're basically a baby, don't have sex. Don't do that.
For some reason, I wrote in quotes, which usually I reserve for normal quotes, but I don't think this is an actual quote. Girls don't want to have sex when I do. What the hell?
Yeah, there's this whole thing in the song where the girls and the guys who are on different sides of the room, which is probably smart considering their behavior... Really, also, incredibly heteronormative scene all around. The guys and girls are... The girls are singing low and the guys are singing high and they're pretending to sing each other's thoughts.
The less said about this probably is better, but it's... To put it into perspective, the song ends with all the girls are doing like an O above their head to simulate the yep. egg?
The vagina.
And
that's the medical term.
You see, Kristen, I thought they were doing the sperm and the egg thing, but no, it's probably your thought where the guys got their hands in such a way to simulate
the dick
in the medical terminology of the term, and they're putting the dick hands between the circle of the vagina.
And the teacher's letting it happen. Like, Mr. Stewart needs to get fired.
And we see in the scene after this, Principal McGee is chiding Mr. Stewart for letting the class get all unruly on this. And there's a girl who comes in and is just like, Principal McGee, I missed my last two periods.
And Principal McGee goes, it's fine, you can make them up after school, and starts to walk away. And then she stares at the camera like, oh no.
Then there should be a rim shot.
I thought that joke was a little bit funny.
That was pretty, I agree, that one wasn't that bad. Honestly, the chorus of the reproduction song, if it were about anything different, apply it to reproduction. If you could get another four-syllable word in there.
if they could take out the plant terminology.
Melon baller, melon baller.
Yeah.
That's fine. Yeah.
Why is melon baller where you went?
It's the first thing that I thought of before syllables. Michael is at a motorcycle graveyard of some sort.
Yep.
And there's a guy here who's just like, all it takes is a little elbow grease and it could turn one of these into a fixer-upper.
Do you already know how to fix a motorcycle? Oh, fantastic. Let's just get this montage going then.
Stephanie's song about a cool rider starts playing
cool
in the back.
Cool rider.
A cool rider.
Keep it cool enough. Better burn me up. I think that's how it goes. Again, all of the depth and technical complexity of a song from Jem.
Michael's having trouble learning to be a cool rider, Kristen. We see here as a cool rider.
Yo, at least they show him practicing.
Yeah, all right. That's good. That is good, at least. Frenchie somehow manages to find him and is, like, watching with concern. And I noticed Michael, when he does fall off the motorcycle, this wasn't in the subtitles, he just goes, bollocks, under his under his breath when he falls one of the times.
Holy shit, calm down, dude.
Frenchie realizes this to try to impress Stephanie, and she doesn't really do anything about it. She just goes, wait a minute, is this for Stephanie? Oh! And that's it.
And he attempts to ride off on his motorcycle after their conversation, but cannot get, like, the kick pedal actually getting the engine to start. So Frenchie hands him his helmet and he just walks away pushing it.
So we go back to A Woman for All Seasons. Again, they're...
Girl?
Whatever. They're doing the winter part. And here's where I said, is this an allegory for the progress of the school year?
Nah.
I mean, it could be, because, I mean, we don't... Again, much like Grease 1, we don't do anything with winter. We barely do anything with spring.
We don't see a snow.
We see the beginning of the year and the end of the year, and that's it, basically. Again, the song is stopped, and Jackie O goes, but there are still two seasons left!
And Principal McGee's like, shut the fuck up, you're gonna be in the talent show. There's barely anyone who wants to audition.
And then Jackie O makes an Ellen Green noise.
Oh, fun!
She just goes, we see the clean-cut guys doing Mr. Sandman, who they...
They're boring and don't matter.
They're boring and don't matter. The T-Birds are next, and they do their, we're going prowling!
Prowling! Talk like a T-Bird. Could be catchy if the lyrics didn't suck.
They don't do a very good job.
No. Principal McGee also calls them the T-Bones, even though she should know better.
She does that later in the movie, too. God damn it, Principal McGee.
She's doing it on purpose.
We cut back to more motorcycling, and then we hear the spring section of the song. So once again, just like...
Yep, here we go.
Kristen, I think we could write Grease 3, and I think we would do a much better job than this movie.
I completely agree. And the way we would do that is we would find a digital copy of the script for Grease 1, select all, copy, paste, and then change some names.
And we'll have, it'll be a soft reboot, and we'll have Eddie Deason in there. It'll be
no!
It'll be about the 80s now.
Joe, just let Eddie Deason die.
You're gonna come back, you're gonna play Mandark one more time!
No! Mandark does not get to be in Grease 3.
We're gonna remake Laser Blast and you're gonna be there!
Stop!
The T-Birds did get into the talent show, and one of them is just like, oh no! Oh, this is terrible. What, we didn't get in? Oh no, it's because we did get in, because I don't want to sing in front of people.
Soft boy.
And then Eddie Deason lets them know that everyone made it in because there weren't enough acts, and then they go chase after Eddie Deason.
Wah, wah, wah.
And then we see the T-Birds watching the guys practicing Mr. Sandman in the locker room. I thought they were just going to beat him up, but no, it's just that they're envious. They save that for later, actually.
Yeah, it's cool. When we cut away, there's more motorcycle stuff happening. Michael is spray painting his motorcycle, which is not how that works.
No, I mean, maybe motorcycles were different where spray painting wouldn't look like garbage.
There's probably lead in that paint, too.
Probably. Wasn't wearing a mask or anything.
Nope. Dumbass.
So we cut to the Bowlerama, and I was really hoping that they would do another song about bowling here.
Let's just do an encore. We don't have enough songs to fill up the movie.
Craterface is here hanging out outside, and before going into the Bowlerama, I believe Dolores goes, SCUM!
Yep, she screams at him. Then she runs in, tells all the T-Birds that Craterface is out there alone, and it's not a trap!
Johnny again does his, you know, oh, cigarette, light, ooh, comb, ooh, let's go kick some ass.
Give me some quarters first, though, because I'm in the middle of a game here.
They have some nice pinball machines there.
I wouldn't know. Well, I do appreciate that when they get interrupted after Johnny smacks the machine, one of the other T-Birds goes, tilt, my turn!
Like, that wasn't completely on purpose. Uh-huh. Like, Johnny, how could you be so stupid putting all your hips into that?
Ugh, it's Silly, silly Johnny. Anyway, I get to play now, right? Oh no, we have to rumble? Shit.
Oh, is that the one who stays inside and comes out later and then Michael has to save him?
I have no idea.
I don't know. Well, anyway, so...
I have no idea.
They head outside and all of the scorpions, the crater face boys are... crater face and his boys. The crater face boys.
No! It's too funny!
Suddenly the entire gang is here, and they do that thing where, you know...
Again, and there's tons of them! This movie had about 3 times as many extras as any fucking movie should have. All of the dance scenes are mob dance scenes because they hired all these people and didn't know that they didn't have to be in every song dancing!
You know, Johnny walks out, he's got the cigarette, and... Does his voice break here again, or does he just kind of, like, turn around?
He starts to cry a little bit.
And they turn around and they leave, and then for some reason, the one Lewis, I don't know who it is, one of the T-Birds didn't notice, I guess.
He is just getting word that they were going to punch out Crater Face's crater lights.
And yeah, he heads outside and he just goes, "Where's Crater Face? Oh!" And then he does it. Okay, so he runs out here and he's just like, "Yeah, where's Crater Face? I'll get him." But there's like, it takes him a second to notice that there's like 20 dudes on motorcycles there.
The adrenaline, man. He was just so excited to rumble.
And then Crater Face grabs him by his jacket and pushes him against the wall. But here comes Mystery Rider, Kristen.
Oh, he's a rider. That's cool.
And he kicks Crater Face.
Shit, that's actually a line from Cool Rider. I forgot.
This movie sucks. Crater Face gets kicked in the chest by the Mystery Rider, and then Crater Face goes, "Get that mother!
Shut your mouth."
I'm just talking about Shaft, Kristen.
Then I can dig it. I feel like that is definitely the whitest version of that that has ever existed. The delivery was as white as it possibly could have been.
So we get a song that I wrote. I believe it was, I don't know if the song is called "Who's That Guy?"
But, it is.
Okay, so the initial line here of "Ooh, who's that guy?" made me laugh a lot mostly because, Kristen, there is a song from the Kamen Rider 3 movie, that plays over the end credits called "Who's That Guy?"
Nice.
So, motorcycles, Kamen Rider, I think Michael might have something going on here he's letting on a little. You know, Steph, when she was singing the song before, she wasn't saying "Cool Rider," Kristen, she was saying "Kamen Rider."
A Kamen Rider.
A Kamen Rider.
I want a rider that is musical artist Kamen.
Damn it, I was going to make that joke. There's a line that I believe Steph sings here. It doesn't really matter that I have it. Steph falls in love with the rider immediately here.
She falls in love with the motorcycle, let's be honest.
She's like, "There's a dude attached to that? Is there like a... Can I get like a motorcycle human centaur? Is that possible?"
What you were referring to is the album art for Lady Gaga's Born This Way.
What I'm referring to is the back glass art for the pinball machine Centaur.
Man, everything's been done, hasn't it? Art is dead.
The Scorpions also threatened to do a Craig Phillips on the Mystery Rider and wrap handlebars around his neck.
Yeah, by the way, for those of you who watched the first movie and thought, "Man, you know who I want to hear sing? Crater Face." You're welcome.
Cops start to arrive, and I wrote this isn't that bad of a song. I would hesitate in saying there's a best song in this movie.
Are you sure the best song isn't "Back to School"?
Does that count? I mean, I
would... Yes, it's in the movie!
I don't know. I mean, the Grease theme is a good song. I don't know if I'd call it...
Okay.
I don't know.
If you don't want to count it as, like, the actors singing it, then fine. Yeah, all of the songs in this movie are bad.
This might be the closest we come to a good song, I'd say.
Yeah, Cool Rider's okay.
Cool Rider's okay. Kind of dumb lyric... whatever. Anyway.
I'm sorry, are you telling me the lyrics are bad? In a song in this movie that's bad?
Everyone heads out. Steph is lagging behind here, and the Pink Ladies are concerned. You know, Steph.
There's been talk, Steph.
There's been talk.
Talk.
They bring up the fact that the Pink Ladies are supposed to belong to the T-Birds, I believe is some
Since
of the verbiage that they use here. And considering later in the movie we get a thing where Johnny tells Stephanie basically, "If you're not going to date me, give me that jacket." Do the T-Birds choose the Pink Ladies? Like, what's going on here?
This seems really sexist. And considering the themes of Grease 1, that's impressive.
Steph might be tired of being somebody's chick. And again, we get the Pink Ladies just go like,
What?
You don't want to be objectified?
I keep remembering, and I should have mentioned it earlier, Paulette now touching on Johnny and everything. That what they aren't doing actually here is the Mean Girls thing, where you can't date someone that your friend has broken up with. That's, like, the rules of feminism.
Setting this shit back a million years, Kristen!
Ugh, the worst. Thank God it's been more than 20 years since Grace 2 came out.
Steph lights up a cig.
Just more than 30 years, I'm sorry, I did bad math.
Takes a sweet drag from that cig. She seems stressed. Paulette can't get a light going because it's just like, what are these shitty matches? Are they from the laundromat? Jesus Christ. And then there's a hand that comes in from off screen to light her cigarette. Boom! Who's that guy?
She looks up, and it's that guy.
The cops arrive, so that guy heads off jumping the cop car in the process. Somehow, I don't know how he does it, but well, he does.
Before he leaves, he does go, one ride, and then cops, and then he goes, maybe later, and then walks away. So again, keeping the words few and far between, because he is faking an American accent. I was just going to ask, are we not supposed to know that this is Michael? Because I cannot believe how stupid the movie would have to assume we are for that to be the case.
This is Michael, yes.
I know it's Michael!
No, I'm just saying.
Don't patronize me.
Anyway, Johnny doesn't look so... That don't impress him much, Kristen. You think you got the looks, but have you got the touch? Now, don't get me wrong. Johnny thinks he's all right, but that will keep him warm in the middle of the night.
I was going to go straight into, you're one of those guys who likes to shine his machine. You make me take off my shoes before you let me get in. I can't believe you kissed your car goodnight. Now, come on, baby, tell me. You must be joking, right? We know... the lyrics to Shania Twain's. That don't impress me much. Way more naturally than I would assume we did.
Kristen, did we not mention that specific verse before?
I am almost positive we have.
Anyway. Frenchie's talking with Michael the next day about what happened, and Michael, she's just like, oh, I heard there was a mysterious Kamen Rider saving people and being a champion of justice. And Michael's just like, oh, that's me!
And Frenchie is psyched. So he says that, hey, next time I see Stephanie, I'm going to tell her the truth. Unfortunately, Stephanie is here right now.
Yeah, Michael sits down and he's just like, I'm going to go, Steph, you and I, and then just the pink ladies come in and he's just like,
yeah, I relate to this. When I don't get time to psych myself up to do basic things, I also freak out a little bit. I have to sit before I make a phone call and go...
Michael goes to talk to Steph, but he can't really seem to get the... I don't know what the fuck... Is he trying to do a thing here with, like, a Clark Kent Superman kind of thing? Because he's just like, have you ever read a Superman comic?
And
she just...
Again, I think you're giving the movie too much credit.
And she goes, not in the last 10 minutes or something like that?
She's so fucking sarcastic. I hate it.
And then, yeah, then Michael just gives up and walks away because she's being too sarcastic.
She's just not listening to him.
Rhonda has a bandage on her nose. She did get a nose job, apparently, but she claims she walked into a door.
I assumed the joke was that they thought she finally got a nose job, but she actually did walk into the door. But I didn't, believe it or not, I wasn't paying super close attention to her nose for the movie. So anytime I saw her, I wasn't thinking, well, let's scope out that nose, shall we? See if there's a difference.
There's a very good chance that she may have just walked into the door. I assume that she got the, I don't know. Again, I was expecting more out of the nose job plot here.
There is nothing.
There is nothing, no. So, hey, Kristen.
Yeah?
Hey, Kristen.
Yeah!
You know what I think might be a good subject for us to make light of in our period piece about the early 1960s?
Hang on, are you sitting on a chair backwards right now?
Hang on, let's wrap real quick. Hey, you know what's fun to make fun of?
Tell me, Joe.
Nuclear war.
Oh, God, it's so funny.
So, we join the next 10 or 15 minutes of the movie is very nuclear holocaust-based.
Yep. You know that thing that everyone was legitimately terrified about in the 60s?
The Cuban missile. Oh, that's hilarious.
Oh my God, it's so funny. The Russians could blow us off the face of the earth if they wanted to.
So Blanche is using like a klaxon here. Is that the proper name of the side? The
I guess so.
Siren? Is it the klaxon? Is that proper? I think they only refer to it as siren.
Yeah, I don't...
The air raid siren.
I'm sure there is like a super specific term for it, but gosh, if I know.
Anyway, Principal McGee is just saying over the loudspeaker, this is only a test. You know, here's what you're going to do when a nuclear holocaust happens. And nobody's really paying attention as it's, you know, a noise that would scare the shit out of people probably in the 1960s.
Mm-hmm. I remember I was taking a history class that went a lot more like deep than most like, you know, casual high school ones do into like what the actual culture was like between like the 30s and about the 80s, I guess. Like they went in depth onto what was going on with people and how they felt about things. And one of the things that we covered is, like, hey, when everyone was, like, super worried about nuclear war, all of the stuff that's, like, all the safety precautions, they were kind of just to make people feel better, because if you were getting bombs dropped on you, yo, hiding under a desk was not gonna help you.
No, that's, I don't remember at what point in my life I realized, that's not really gonna help, but everyone probably thought, hey, you know, at least you can reduce the rubble that's going to fall on you. That might be the best we could do.
Yeah, if the bombs are very far away.
If you don't get vaporized entirely.
Yeah. Gosh, I hope I'm vaporized. It sounds kind of cool.
That's how I want to go, Kristen.
Yeah, why not?
Vaporized by a nuclear weapon.
If I'm lucky, I will do a Fallout thing and just turn into a ghoul. I'll be like Moira.
Coach Calhoun is in the hallway here. He is explaining nuclear war to students, or like what do they refer to this as in Metal Gear, Kristen? Where if somebody launches a nuke, it's somebody else will launch a nuke, and it just immediately fucking everybody starts launching nukes at each other.
I know that term too. That's the whole thing with Peace Walker, is Peace Walker would absolutely retaliate. So that's how they would prevent other people from firing at them, because the question of retaliation was the variable.
Right. Well, that's nuclear deterrence is what that is. That might be what I'm thinking of.
Maybe. Full, complete nuclear annihilation.
Yeah. Isn't nuclear war hilarious?
We have so much stuff to look forward to in the future.
So we cut to Lewis. No, this is Lewis. Is it? I don't know. Whatever. This one here and Jackie O are going to some bomb shelter. I said some bomb shelter. It's technically... what, Michael's uncle's bomb shelter?
Yeah, apparently gets free bone zone pass. Like how everyone uses Kaneki's car as a sex car.
He breaks in. It's not like he asked for permission, I don't think.
Okay, I guess so.
But yeah, it's the bomb shelter Michael was in earlier. The other T-Birds are outside here to play a joke. One of them has a klaxon, which, if you're going to do an isolated thing here with helping your bud have sex with his lady by making a nuclear siren, I think it's not going to be quiet enough so that nobody else is going to hear it.
Yeah. Wait, hang on. Joe.
Yes.
They didn't think this plan through.
You don't say.
Yeah, I'm beginning to think.
Anyway, Kristen, now we get a song. Now we get a song.
I want to hear your thoughts as you realized what this song was about.
In my notes, I mean, I had a good idea, and my note about this is, now is not the time for a song.
Uh-huh.
Followed by, have you ever been so desperate to get sex that you've simulated a nuclear war?
Mm-hmm. Go on.
Followed by, nah, fuck this.
Yeah, basically. So this is Do It For Our Country, I guess it's called, and it's basically whoever this T-Bird is saying, Uncle Sam really wants me to put my dick in you.
It's the bowling song again, except this time it's about nuclear war, because it's all just allegories about about Bone Zone.
And unfortunately, Jackie O, the metaphors are going over her head, so she assumes that he is telling her that they need to get ready to go join the army to help their country.
Right. God bless her, Kristen. She is American to the core. She doesn't care about sex. She cares about JFK.
Mm-hmm. God, I would too.
I care about JFK.
Still now? You are so dedicated.
And yes, the song ends with her going, you know, I'm ready. And then she gets up and is just like, I'm ready to join the army.
Let's go sign up now. So she rushes out, but all the rest of the T-Birds fall in. And she is like, are you kidding me?
You made me believe a fucking nuclear war was going on outside. What the fuck?
So, she leaves. And they still end up a couple at the end of the movie.
They do, which is really, yeah. I mean, I would have liked Kristen if there was some kind of plot with her where she considers dropping out to become, like, a field nurse or something like that. That would have been nice.
You expect too much.
I do.
Some more fun stuff happens.
Steph is here at a gas station. This is where she works. It's like Jake's Oil and Lube or something stupid like that. It doesn't really matter. But anyway, she's doing, you know, it's like, oh, I need some maps. I need to get my change. I need to get my windshield washed. And then the mystery rider shows up not wearing a shirt under his leather jacket, Kristen.
Yep, and it is zipped down to his belly button. Looking about two steps away from Yarinika.
All he needs is a bench. He's just using a motorcycle instead. So he offers her a ride, and she's just like, fuck it, I'm young, and I probably, you know, I'm not gonna work for the rest of my life at a fucking gas station, who cares? So she gets on and rides off with him.
And then, we got more of Cool Rider.
A sexy saxophone version of Cool Rider plays.
Oh, good, because that's what I wanted.
That was a pretty bad saxophone, you'll have to excuse me.
It was not great. Come on, Kenny G.
He plays the clarinet, Kristen!
He does?
I think.
I don't think so.
Yanni might be the one with the saxophone. I don't know. Fucking. Anyway, Steph ends up, like, straddling his waist as they're doing this, too. Like, she goes, she's behind him, and then she gets in front of him, and that's very dangerous.
Oh my god, it is a clarinet. Yeah, Michael's really lucky he got so good at riding a fucking motorcycle, isn't he?
So yeah, there's the sexy saxophone, a cool rider playing in the background. They kiss in the sunset, and Steph is smitten to say the least. Kristen, how is Michael gonna fuck this one up?
Oddly enough, it's not really him.
No, it's actually, I mean, he has a good reason to leave, I guess. I mean, he could, fuck it, whatever. I wrote in my notes at this point, I would much rather Michael be Frankenstein than Michael.
It's probably a good thing that the reveal doesn't really happen here, because he attempts to do it. But though Wikipedia seems more convinced than I actually am, toward the end of the movie, Stephanie starts to clearly like Michael more than she did before. Right. So it's a little bit of a softer, oh, you're Michael, then, ah, oh, it's Michael.
Right, yes. We're getting another gem situation here where Stephanie starts to fall in love with Michael as well as the cool rider.
Who is he kissing?
Or is she riding a motorcycle with a fantasy? He makes a date with her for the talent show as he rides off because the T-Birds are here and he can't reveal himself at this point. And she's just like, the talent show? But how did he know?
How did this clearly high school aged person know about the talent show? I wonder what it must be like with the secret identity thing. This mystery guy comes and you have no idea who he is, and you are so fucking certain that he isn't someone you know that you can't even consider that he would be. I'm sorry, I'm making way too big of a deal out of this. Continue. I'm sick of this movie.
The T-Birds and the Pink Ladies are wondering what the hell Steph's deal is here, and Johnny still thinks that Steph is his girl rather than Paulette, which Paulette does not take too kindly to.
Everyone gets angry on her behalf, which is nice. They're kind of good friends to each other, or they try to be.
Yeah. And hey, that's good to see that because Paulette's getting the shit end of the stick here, all the other Pink Ladies are like, dude, what the fuck?
Yep, but it doesn't matter that they don't have ladies to go to the bone zone with. Also, not that it matters because they seem to make a point constantly that everyone in this movie is a virgin. So whatever. But they're gonna go prowling.
Johnny has a plan. Yes, they're going prowling. I wrote in my notes, another song starts, fuck. And prowling isn't a terrible song.
It's a confusing song.
I'm confused mostly because the lead up to this is Johnny going, I think I know a place where we could get some grade A ladies. And it's like, are they going to the red light district? What are they doing here? And we learn that he's talking about the grocery store?
You have in your notes, is this a euphemism? And I think the fact that we, two adults, cannot figure out how this would work as a euphemism means it's not, which is more confusing.
There's something where he's talking about, like, there's a butcher. Like, is that a, like, are we talking, what do we, what is the song doing?
I give the butcher
doing?
My meat. And then she chops it off.
Weren't there, like, 3 or 4 jokes about that in the Brady Bunch movie with Sam and Alice?
Joe, it's been a very long time since I've seen the Brady Bunch movie, and I was not old enough to get any of those jokes when I did.
We should do the Brady Bunch movie.
Oh my god, we should do the Brady Bunch movie.
Oh, anyway, so this turns into their talent show performance, basically. So they were what started as them trying to get sex turned into them practicing for the talent show.
Good for them. And there's weird silhouettes of ladies working at a grocery store in the background that have big old boobies.
Hans Booby.
They have this whole dialogue part of the song where they talk about what they like in a girl. And the last guy's like, I like a girl who's smart and has huge tits.
That one was Goose. So good on you, Shooter McGavin.
Bad on you, Shooter McGavin.
We cut back to, there's a class now going on with Miss Mason. Steph needs to stay behind after class because her essay on William Shakespeare wasn't that great.
Apparently Miss Mason is the only teacher in the school because this isn't music appreciation. This is clearly...
Wait a minute!
Do they only hire young-looking people? Like, do they not have enough actual, like, adults to have someone be a different teacher?
I don't know. There's some luau on Saturday. We're already near the point of the talent show, because, yeah, well, he had said the talent show on Friday. Luau on Saturday.
The movie from here on out is more nonsense. Surprise.
Michael stops to talk to Steph and offers to help her with the William Shakespeare paper, and I'll think about it. But we join a study session in progress at a diner.
And man, it's awkward.
Steph has a lot on her mind. More than the paper, but forget it. So there's this guy.
Forget it. Well, but I mean, I met this guy. Well, don't worry about it, but I mean, he came out of nowhere.
I have this idea of Mr. Right, but forget it. Doesn't matter. I find the fact that he wears goggles weird, but like not weird weird, but like exciting weird, like alluring,
but like a tiddling kind of weird in a way that like I'm kind of talking about like my kind of sexual response to you, who I don't really know very well. I know that's kind of weird, and maybe I'm oversharing a little bit. Anyway, when you get hamburgers, do they ever not give you ketchup?
Somebody get me some goddamn ketchup.
And then she screams and tears the entire place apart, and now I think I'm just describing pizzazz.
But anyway, back to Hamlet.
Pizzazz killed a man to get some ketchup.
And hamburgers. And the mystery writer.
And he reads part of her paper where Steph basically wrote in her Hamlet essay. Hamlet flipped his shit when he saw that his mom was doing it with his uncle.
And Michael is just like, well, how about instead it's that Hamlet was aghast when he saw the incestuous relationship partaking between his mother and his uncle.
And she laughs a lot, and she's like, I'm definitely going to write that down. This is amazing. She starts to call herself stupid.
Well, one thing is, she writes the word incestuous in there because she thinks that it's going to make the teacher freak out.
High schoolers,
yeah.
I probably did stuff like that.
And then, yeah, she goes, you must think I'm some kind of dummy. And he goes, actually, I think you're sort of terrific.
And he says, I'm not really that smart. I just know some big words that teachers like. I think that means he's smart.
Taking a page out of the Book of Joe, Kristen, here, where writing, you don't really understand the concept, but if you use enough big words, it might sound like you know what you're doing.
I believe when I was in high school and you had gone off to college, that was exactly the advice you gave me when I was writing my final English paper. You were like, the secret to getting a good enough word count and still getting a good grade is just throw as much shit at the wall as possible and see what sticks.
Be flowery. Be overly flowery.
Repeat the same point several times using different words. And also, if all else fails, make those periods a little bit bigger.
I forget how exactly the exchange goes here, where Steph starts saying, something happens where she ends up using whom in a situation where who is more appropriate. So now, again, Steph taking a page out of the Book of Joe.
That's what I was thinking, too. She tells him, learn how to take a compliment. They're bonding, I guess. And she yells, how about a burger for my friend? Which is not how you signal over a waiter.
Garçon, more coffee, please.
Excuse me. You. Any of you, really. I'm not picky.
Burger. Now.
Ketchup. Double ketchup. Triple ketchup. God, triple ketchup sounds like a nightmare.
That really, yeah. I hesitate with single ketchup sometimes.
Yeah, ketchup is not a make or break for me on a burger. I like mayo a lot more on my burger.
So Michael asks Steph out at this point, and she says, oh no, we're different types. There's a pink lady code.
Well, to quote Dolores, the code stinks. And he gets kind of like salty and wants to leave.
And then Johnny and Goose arrive. Johnny wants Steph to know, all right, so Steph, I had it in writing. I talked to my attorney. I think, according subsection 15 here, you and I are officially a split.
We are Splitsville. And if you go cry about it, now would be a really good time because then maybe I'd see that you care.
And Steph's response is essentially, all right, bye.
She's a little bit exasperated, like, as if her deciding that she didn't want to date him anymore didn't already mean that they weren't dating.
And then here's where Johnny goes, all right, okay, so you better give me that jacket, because that's T-Bird property.
And she does not give it to him.
Johnny's a little broken up about this. He goes and he punches a thing before walking into wherever, like, the diner that they were, and then Goose punches it right after. Oh, Goose.
Mm-hmm. And he shakes his hand a little bit, like, I need my golfing hand to be good.
We join the lunch. I don't know, Kristen, everything seems to escalate to an odd degree at this point in the movie where we join the lunchroom. Steph kind of gets, like, pushed into Michael, and she doesn't really look like she wants to talk to him. She just kind of, like, moves away. And then Michael, then we have charade. Charades? Whatever. Michael's song here.
Charades.
Michael's song here of him being
in heaven
forever.
Get ready, because I'm going to do that very soon again.
Oh, I... Oh, Michael.
I think it's Stephanie. Stephanie is who the song is about.
Michael's singing a song about himself in the persona of the Easy Rider.
God, what is the Easy Rider now?
He turned into Dennis Hopper when I wasn't looking.
No, now he's Knight Rider. Help!
So, yeah, this song is, it's Michael, he's doing the Gem song here, where it's just like, I can't be two people.
Except he's only been doing it for one school year. Jem's been doing it forever.
And he's, like, drawn a heart in a notebook. There's something going on with the twins. They're like, oh, look at this. Programs with a talent. I don't know why I wrote this down. Somebody just said something in the middle of the song where I wasn't writing notes, so I wrote it down.
Great, cool. Because the song is really interesting. Again, one of my issues with how this movie was directed, the very beginning of this song is him just standing in the lunchroom looking like a sad asshole while he's not singing, he just hears the fucking music.
Which, oddly
enough... Who made this movie? Joe! This movie has made me believe that I could be a director.
And we get the same thing happen with Michelle Pfeiffer later, where she just kind of stands there staring out into nothing as a song starts.
They go catatonic and a song happens.
And here's where it took me this long for me to write the note, did they really need to make Michael Sandy's cousin?
Like, suddenly you just realize that he is still that, and it makes no fucking difference whatsoever.
There's no reason for him to be.
No.
Alright, anyway, Michael makes his way to the piano on the talent show stage. I thought he was gonna play it, but he doesn't, so there we go.
It's his only friend now.
We see people getting their pictures taken. Tonight is the talent show. The mystery writer appears outside to get Steph, but the T-Birds are here, and they're like, aha, we're gonna catch that guy.
I think we're gonna kill him, I guess. Oh no, we actually did!
So yeah, a thing happens here where...
Regret!
They leave, and the T-Birds chase, and the Pink Ladies in their car pick up Steph and chase him as well. And they go to a place called Dead Man's Curve, and we see, like, a big jump, and the T-Birds arrive, and they're like, oh, wait a minute, I thought he was gonna slow down, but he didn't slow down, oh no!
We never get a single shot of what this jump actually looks like beyond the, like, mound of dirt that has a motorcycle track in it, so we don't know what the fuck it looked like or how dangerous it's supposed to be. Apparently it is so deep that there is literally nothing down there.
It's just a black abyss.
Yeah. Oh no, he fell into the void!
Not the shadow realm!
Fuck!
Anyway... Yeah, they all assume he died making the jump. His body is into the ravine, so he may not be dead. And then Steph is
okay,
just like...
Okay, to be fair, they don't assume he's dead. They keep very weakly assuring each other that he's totally alive because the T-Birds, especially Johnny, is clearly like, oh, dude, I did not want to actually, like, kill someone. He's like, no, he made the jump. I can make that jump, so he probably made that jump. He's fine.
Right, yeah, okay, so that's how it is for most of the T-Birds. But yeah, they do use good evidence in the fact that his body is not in the ravine, that there's nothing down there. Again, this is where there's nothing down there comes from.
All the Pink Ladies are like, he's probably fine. He jumped over a cop car once. Steph is being a negative fucking Nancy, though.
Yeah, she assumes that she's never gonna see Michael, well, the mystery writer ever again.
Mystery writer.
Anyway, time for the talent show. A man in a green suit sings a song.
They put out a casting call for a guy who can overact the most and found this person and apparently thought it was going to be funny.
Johnny sees Paulette dressed in risque fashion and he ain't having it, and then Paulette ain't taking it.
Yeah, she starts to shove him and yell at him. She is taller than him in whatever shoes she is wearing, so she looks super threatening and awesome. And she eventually pushes him right on stage and everyone laughs because both of them are on stage.
And Johnny ends up being Luau King even after this terrible event.
I guess their song was okay. Also, they fuck up their competition.
Yeah, stiff competition in the form of Martin Meisner and his red hot accordion.
Yay. Yeah, they go into the locker room where the Mr. Sandman guys, that's the song they sang before. I don't know if we ever actually mentioned it.
Yeah, I think I referred to them as Mr. Sandman. Whatever, fuck it.
Okay, the three preppy dudes, they are practicing in the bathroom because obviously the acoustics are fucking great in there. And they tie them up around one of the showers and then turn on the water just because they're dicks.
And they put a bar of soap in one of their mouths. We cut back to Martin Meisner. His red hot accordion is not all that red hot, and it's time for the T-Bones. T-Birds, T-Bones, the T-Bones.
Whatever. So we get to hear part of that song again, and then it's over.
Yeah, rapturous applause is what I wrote for the Netflix subtitles there. So they did a good job, I guess.
Sure. So now we finally do all of Girl for All Seasons.
Most of it, because again, at the end, we go through, yeah, all
well,
the seasons.
Yeah, that's true.
There's nothing really to say about the Girl for All Seasons song, because it just, Steph is winter. I don't know if she's like December. Everyone's got like a month on them or something.
She's dressed as a Christmas tree, Joe. What month do you think she is?
October.
Yeah, probably. I see in your notes that you also use the word catatonic.
I did, because she stops at like, she just stops singing the song after a while and is standing at like the edge of the stage.
I don't think she ever started singing.
She was looking down, the way that her gaze was going, it looked like it was going down towards the audience, and I thought that she was going to see the mystery writer in the audience, but no, she's just looking, according to my notes, positively catatonic, staring off into nothingness.
Joe, now might be a good time to mention that Michael is playing the piano for the talent show.
He would be, wouldn't he? Huh. Yeah.
Yeah, so there's really no mystery as to whether or not he's dead, if, again, the viewer was supposed to wonder whether or not Michael was dead, because then wouldn't somebody go, where's Michael and why isn't he playing the fucking piano?
That would have been cool too if they had to do a scene where it's just like, where's Michael? We need someone else to play the piano, and then someone else plays the piano.
Nope, we don't have time for that in this 2-hour-long movie with way too much filler in the first place.
Oh, so yeah, Steph is remembering the shit that happened 5 minutes ago with the mystery writer, whatever. She kind of ruins the performance, and then she starts her own song here.
Yeah, good thing Michael had the sheet music for this nonsense.
This impromptu song. What was the song called again? Love Will Turn Back the Hands of Time or something like that?
In parentheticals, Love Will Turn Back the Hands of Time.
She just, yeah, this impromptu performance. I wrote, lady, this isn't your performance.
In heaven! Forever!
Michael appears...
Never we will be. Heaven. Motorcycles. Stephanie.
Michael appears in, yeah, motorcycle heaven, or like a motorcycle pile of white motorcycle skeletons, as I referred to it.
It's a cool-looking set. It's wasted.
It's a weird dream sequence. I don't understand. I don't know. I didn't write anything about this song, because I just wrote, is this
all... She's a Greco-Roman robe dress on.
Everybody cheers at the end, and like this was supposed to be
part
of the
plan. We missed something. She's wearing a headband that has a Christmas star on it, like a tree, because she's dressed like a tree, by the way.
Right.
And she takes it off of her head, and then a wire pulls it away out into the distance, and she's like, oh my god.
What? I didn't remember. Well, again, not really paying
you
attention.
Did you see that?
I miss pretty
obvious. Yeah, her star
sometimes
flies out above the audience, and that's where the Knight Rider comes.
Oh, I don't know. Johnny and Steph win King of
Queen. But, yeah, she wins the talent show.
Yeah, Johnny and Steph win King and Queen, respectively, of the luau, and Steph does not look too happy. And here we go right into Rockahula Luau, Kristen. What the fuck is going on with this song?
Hey, remember that song with the nonsense words from the other movie?
Rockahula Luau, ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba.
Ram-a-lam-a-lam-a of Rockahula Luau.
Steph really isn't dressed in the spirit of luau either. She's wearing
a... Sure, you know what would make this movie a lot better?
What's that?
If this entire song were just replaced with the luau song from The Lion King.
What was the luau song in The Lion King? What? I don't remember that.
Timon and Pumbaa are talking about how they need to distract the hyenas near the end of the movie. And Timon says, what do you want me to do? In his Nathan Lane voice, dress up in drag and do the hula. And then there's a short song where he's saying that they spit roasted Pumbaa. And he was good for eating. I encourage you to look it up.
It's been a long time since I've seen The Lion King.
I don't know why I remember that specifically.
Anyway, it's suddenly nighttime now. I wrote that this is basically the climax of the movie, and I really don't care.
That doesn't surprise me.
It's suddenly nighttime at this point. Principal McGee quotes JFK, and it's time for the king and queen. You know, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what, you know, get on the boat. King and queen of the luau, everyone. Enchantment all up on the moon. Whatever.
We can afford a pool.
Yeah, the pool. That's weird.
Johnny and Steph just kind of... It sounds like they are improvising an argument, because it is nonsense that doesn't mean anything and is boring. But oh shit, Joe.
The scorpions are here.
And they ruined the luau.
They're here to rock you like a hurricane, and they break all this shit. Oh my god.
That's what you get for being culturally insensitive.
Oh, but here he is. It's the mystery rider, and like 3 or 4 people go, it's him.
I just heard Ode to Joy in my head again.
And the mystery writer doesn't really do anything other than, like, jump the pool that Michelle Pfeiffer and Johnny are in. And then some other people attempt to do it. But at this point, Michelle Pfeiffer and Johnny are out of the pool so they don't get hit with motorcycles flying at them.
Yeah, which is weird because in the continuity of the movie, they're still in the fucking pool and they don't get out for a little bit still. So there's just 2 pools. It's some nonsense is what I am saying.
And this is the cause for their defeat, I guess, is him doing a really cool trick and they can't match it. So the Scorpions are defeated at this point. They got to go back to Germany or wherever the band the Scorpions came from. And Michael reveals himself as the mystery rider at this point. Steph runs to him. Johnny is more than a little pissed. And Johnny, I don't know, Kristen, something like a a switch flips in Johnny or something here.
He goes through a roller coaster of emotions in a matter of seconds.
Because he's just like, oh no, I'm going to kill this guy. Wait a minute, no, we still got one more jump you need to make. I thought Johnny was going to challenge him to like a motorcycle contest, but no, he...
He said, first kiss me and then you'll be a T-Bird.
And then he goes, jacket! And Goose throws the jacket a little too early at Johnny and it hits Paulette. And then he looks over at Paulette and is just like, okay, jacket, please.
No, see, that's the thing. It slaps her and it looks irritated and then looks over at Paulette and she looks at him like, you don't order me to give you your jacket. So I thought what was going to happen is that he would go, Paulette, may I have my jacket?
Not the case.
But no, he just kind of softens a little bit and goes, jacket.
And
that's enough for Paulette.
And yeah, and she gives him the jacket and he goes, well, before we do anything here, I just want to see how it looks. And he puts the jacket on Michael and everybody's like, oh, he's a T-Bird now.
Yay! You could date now, even though we just are going to graduate. So you could be a T-Bird for like a couple of days, I guess.
Steph and Michael are about to embrace, but Dolores gets in the way and she's like, Michael, can't really see each other anymore. Got another man on my hands. Can't, you know, washing my hands of the situation here. But hey, if you want to see other women, that's fine with me. No skin off my back.
Dolores.
And then Michael kisses her cheek and then whispers something to her. And what does she say? Her response? Like,
I don't remember.
She said,
it's
not
important.
I thought this was going to go somewhere, but it doesn't.
Nope. Who cares?
Michael and Steph kiss. There's no music or anything, so it's really awkward.
This is one of those things I was talking about where, like, this scene takes way too long and all you hear is lip smacking. And it's kind of like, okay. And then they have their whole, like, conversation that leads into the last song in, like, a completely steady shot.
It's something along the lines of, I never thought you'd accept me for who I am, blah, 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 whatever, I like you, so fucking whatever.
She's like, I get two for one.
Are you certain?
I've never been certainer.
And I wrote in my notes, he's gonna say more certain. And sure enough, more certain.
You know what I love, Joe?
What's that?
Someone who corrects my grammar.
And now, here you go. Here are the last notes I have for this movie, Kristen. Last song. Fuck, I don't care. Johnny accepts Paulette. Whatever, everyone's together. Graduation. Is this movie over?
Graduation by Vitamin C Play is in the movie is over.
Oh, anyway, that was... Kristen, I don't care enough to mention anything about the last song. That was Grease 2.
It certainly was.
That was Grease 2. It is what it is. Kristen, why don't you give me your thoughts on Grease 2?
It's worse than I remember.
Yeah. Yeah, it's bad.
Like, I remember being really unimpressed with the songs and everything, but, like, this time... Because it's definitely been a while since I've seen Grease 2. I really can't remember specifically the last time I watched it. It might have been within the last 4 years when I was in college. But before that, I definitely remember catching it on whatever same channel occasionally also played just within the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. I mean, just being like, oh shit, it's Grease 2. I need to watch this. I remember when we were younger, me saying to mom once, like, me just finding out that Grease 2 existed. And because when I was little, I was always psyched about Grease. I was like, oh my god, mom, there's a second Grease movie. And I remember her saying to me, oh, it's really bad, Kristen, you don't want to see that. And I, like, just didn't understand. I was so upset by that news, and then I saw it and went, oh, no!
Oh, I see, of course. Kristen, I will tell you, I thought it would be fun to at least make fun of Grease 2, but, and it has been, it's been fun making fun of, have complained about it, I don't even know if we've made fun of it.
It would be strange if we didn't in there somewhere. I'm sorry I hurt you.
No, this is one of those things where I expected Grease 2 would be one of those kind of like, oh, this is a bad movie, but I'm going to get enjoyment out of how bad it is, where instead it's just like, this is the worst type of movie where it's boring and like not, like it's trying, but it's not trying hard enough to keep me invested, so I can't write stupid jokes about it.
Yep, and like the dialogue is so predictable that we can't make jokes about that really. And, like, when it's not being predictable, it makes that jump into, like, Big Trouble in Little China levels of indecipherable.
I don't watch this movie, basically. That's what I... For all you prospective fans of Grease out there, don't watch this movie.
I'm glad Michelle Pfeiffer is doing okay.
I am, too. I'm glad, there's wasted potential, maybe, is what I could call Grease 2. Like, it's there, it should have been, it could have been good, but it wasn't.
Is there potential? if it shouldn't have existed in the first place. Like, when you think of unnecessary sequels, a sequel to a musical. Like, oh yeah, and then after this, Phantom of the Opera 2.
Jesus Christ Superstar 2.
Yeah. Well, Cats 2 actually does sound like it could be pretty cool.
No, maybe. I don't know what the plot of Cats is, so if all the main characters are, like, dead...
Me neither.
They've got to be in, like, cat hell or something.
I find Cats creepy and upsetting.
Agreed. But I find this movie creepy and upsetting.
Great!
Now's the point in the evening where I will list off all of the fun contact things where you could find us. You can follow us on Twitter at cwtapod. You could give me a follow at Octopus, that is AWKTAPUS.
You can reach me for formal apologies to each individual who listens to this episode or watches this movie as a result of this episode at FunnyGirlTM, like trademark.
You can find us on the iTunes, on the SoundCloud, on the Stitcher Radio. Leave a rating, give a review, do whatever you feel like. Tell us how bad Grease 2 is. Tell us if you have any Grease 2 memories. Drop us a line, cwtapod@gmail.com, where you can tell us all about, like, the safety of riding a motorcycle with no undershirt, but with, like, a leather jacket, and which season of girl you is.
I think I'll probably fall.
I'm gonna fall down after this podcast episode.
No, Joe, what season of girl are you?
I'm the winter of my discontent with... Fuck off!
You're a nuclear winter.
I am a nuclear winter, thank you. Next week, Kristen, we are going to finish what we started. Because, Kristen, this podcast and this next movie, we have unfinished business.
I had a feeling that's where you were going, and I'm sad I didn't get to say it. Should I say it now in Japanese?
Next week, Kristen, we are doing Kill Bill Volume 2, finishing up our Kill Billigy here, which I guess Grease 2 is our interlude.
Yeah, now we're in a really good place to go back to mindless violence, death and destruction, fashion and fame.
This is the, Grease 2 is the let's all go to the lobby section of this trilogy here, so I understand if you wanted Kill Bill 2 this week, but fuck off, you gotta wait another week.
We tricked you! And Kill Bill is our last movie before we're going back to Gem, right?
Yep, that is indeed. So we got Kill Bill next week, Gem the week after that. I can't wait to get back to Gem because I hate editing. I'm going to hate editing this episode, Kristen.
Yeah, have fun with that. Man, I'm so glad I don't have to edit this shit.
I want to be done with Grease 2, and I don't want it to go on any longer.
You have
longer
to listen to this all over again.
So for the Can We Talk About podcast, my name is Joe.
I am Kristen. I'm sorry.
And join us next week when we cannot wash our hands of this sin.
Your formal apology, MLA format, double spaced, 12-point font, is in the mail.